In the Zone, presented by TD.
It's In the Zone, presented by TD. Ben Ennis and Mike Wilner in our super secret location that we record from on the moon.
Yep,
it's great. It's great. It's great up here. No, we're not at Rogers Center. Although I guess we should start saying
we're
that we are
floating above Rogers Center.
Yeah, we're floating.
That's where we are.
Yeah,
right
we're
now.
Suspended above Rogers Center. It's really, really cool. Hmm. Mike, we got to start with the Yunel Escobar thing because we haven't had a take. We haven't done a video podcast since the Escobar situation. It seems to have died down quite a bit, but he hasn't returned yet from his 3-game suspension. And I think by now everybody knows the situation, the writing under in the eye black on the Saturday game at Rogers Center against the Boston Red Sox. What's your overall take?
My overall take, without putting too fine a point on it, is that he's an idiot. And that's basically what it comes down to, yeah. Right? This was not motivated by hate. It's not gay bashing. There's no bigotry involved. This is just someone doing something really, really, really stupid that he thought was funny. And that's what it comes down to. I mean, I kind of think of it like, and I don't know how many people that are watching, it's on the internet, so many young people are watching us, but I don't know how many who are watching us have kids. But it's like if your 10-year-old does something just phenomenally stupid, and you sit him down and you say, why'd you do that? I mean, you knew, why'd you do that? And they say, I don't know. And they mean it. They don't know. It's the same thing with him. He thought it would be funny. Why do you think it would be funny? I don't know why I thought it would be funny. He thought it would be funny. He was incredibly wrong. It was a huge, massive error in judgment. But it wasn't motivated by hate. I mean, this is just something stupid that he did. So I don't think he should be pilloried for it. And I don't think that, you know, people should be calling him a bigot or anything like that. It's... you can't legislate against stupidity, and hopefully he learns the lesson and he starts to understand that even if something is acceptable in a clubhouse, even if you think it's hilarious, even if you know, I mean, there's no Spanish speaker on earth who doesn't know what that word means, whether that's the way he meant it or not. That's what it means. And you got to know that when there's potentially millions of people watching you, you don't write that on your face.
On your face. Like, I mean, how stupid.
Seriously, how stupid do you have to be?
We're going
to
move on.
We found out.
We're going to move on from this in just a second, but I got to ask you, I mean, it seems like Adany Echevarria is the shortstop in waiting for the Blue Jays.
Yep.
He's hit a lot better recently.
Yep.
We know he's a great defender.
Yep.
Yunel Escobar has been brutal offensively this year.
Yep.
He was great last year. Another year left on the deal. It's a pretty good deal,
mm-hmm.
despite the fact that he wasn't great offensively. I mean, could we be seeing the changing of the guard shortstop-wise for the Blue Jays and maybe then thinking about dealing Escobar? Obviously, his value is very low right now.
Yeah, that's the problem, right?
Mm-hmm.
His value was low anyway coming off a bat. If he hit 300 this year, first of all, I don't know if the controversy would have been as great if he was hitting 300. But if he was hitting 300, there would be teams waiting to lap him up. Give him a second chance. Everybody deserves a second chance. But he's hitting 250, and he's having a terrible year offensively. And he's starting to rub people the wrong way the same way that he started to rub people the wrong way in Atlanta. So I think the trade value is really, really low. And if there's one thing we know about Alex Anthopoulos, so he doesn't like to move people when their trade value is really, really low, if he anticipates that it's going to go back up. If he doesn't, Travis Snyder, Asher Wojciechowski, Kevin Comer, guys like that, if he doesn't anticipate that their value is going to go up, then he will move them, and not necessarily for the best return. But I don't think he gets traded. I just don't think he gets back enough right now.
Yeah, maybe not. Omar Vizquel is obviously better than Babe Ruth.
Yes.
Because he has more hits.
Correct.
He did that in the Bronx at Yankee Stadium. Okay, Omar Vizquel, he's been a bench player on this team. I don't think he's pretty much done what I expected, I think. And maybe a little
probably
less.
Do a little better, yeah.
A little less, but he's 45.
Yep.
So what are you going to do? All right, I don't know if there's much you can say about passing Babe Ruth except the longevity.
It's really cool. Regardless.
Yeah, it's cool. It is, but it's an accounting statistic. Obviously hits.
Yeah, and he has way more plate appearances.
Oh.
Many more at-bats, like almost 2,000, I think.
Is he a Hall of Famer in your eyes?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. Absolutely.
And do you make the association with Ozzie Smith because he's in the Hall of Fame?
Uh-huh.
Really?
Sure.
But Ozzie was a much better defender.
No, he wasn't. No, he wasn't. He wasn't. He wasn't a much better defender. Ozzie Smith.
He was a better defender.
Probably, but when you're talking in these levels,
mm-hmm.
if Ozzie Smith is the best defensive shortstop ever, Omar Vizquel was the next best defensive shortstop ever, and he was right there with him.
Where are the offensively? Where, I mean, are they on the same level? Because
Ozzie couldn't hit for the first 10 years of his career.
But Omar's career OPS is below 700, is it not?
That wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's not a good hitter. But he hit for average, and he had some years where he was an offensive contributor. He's never going to be, you know, neither was Ozzie. He was never an OPS guy. Ozzie Smith didn't learn to hit till 10, 15 years into his career, and Omar had a few years that were okay, but it doesn't matter.
I mean, Omar can't do a backflip, though.
Sure he can. There are two...
You don't know that.
There are people who get in the Hall of Fame based on offense only. So I don't have a problem with people getting in the Hall of Fame based on defense only. And the fact that he's close to 3,000 hits when he finishes it all, even though...
No way he gets to 3,000.
No. But he's a Hall of Famer for me.
Interesting. He's past Babe Ruth, so that's great. And I'm sure he has that ball. He's going to put it on his mantle as well.
At the bat, too.
And the bat as well. Some of the Blue Jays' younger hitters starting to hit a little bit better. Anthony Gose was maybe cooled off a little bit, but
still doing all right.
Adani Hechavarria certainly starting to show something. Chad Mottola, the hitting instructor down in Vegas, looks like he's going to be on the Blue Jays staff next season. We'll get into that in just a second, but we got a chance to catch up with Mr. Mottola down at the ballpark.
Chad, you look at so many of the guys that you've seen down in Vegas this year getting a chance to perform in the major leagues for the first time, Anthony Gose and Moises Sierra. It's so many guys that have ended up by necessity for the most part here with the Blue Jays. I mean, what can you say about the crop of hitters that have gone through Vegas this season?
Unfortunately, a lot of them got here a little earlier than anticipated, but a lot of them held their own. And now I get to come up here and settle them down a little bit, and they get to see a familiar face that they've been with all year. So that's what I want to try and do.
A lot of people make a big deal about the Pacific Coast League and Cashman Field in particular down in Vegas. How much of an impact does that have, and does it almost over, does it really inflate the numbers to the degree that we understand it to?
I think it gets exaggerated sometimes, but this year we grew the grass out a little bit, and pitchers' numbers this year were greatly improved. I think the team ended with about a 4-5, and I don't think they've been under a 6 in a couple years. So this year is a little more realistic.
It's interesting too, Chad, that you know, we see Anthony Gose, we see Adani Hechavarria, we see Moises Sierra here. Moises really hit the ground running and slipped back. Gose and Hetch really haven't gotten into that yet. But I talked to Scott Richmond when he was up here briefly, and I said to him, hey, look at those numbers that Hetch and Gose have put up. Are they Vegas or are they legit? And he said to me, there's no question in his mind, those two guys can hit.
I mean, all you have to do is look at a guy like Trout, what he's doing this year compared to what he did last year. There's nothing that replaces experience. And the more they slow the game down, the more they just go out and play, the better off they are. So it's one of those things that you kind of suffer through the growing pains, but in the end, you're going to get a better player by suffering through it.
I want to ask you about one guy who's not here anymore, but who you had a lot this year, and that's Travis Snyder. There was a lot of fan angst when he got traded. He was a favorite of mine. I love the kid, and think that he's going to be a great, great hitter in the game. You have to give up something to get something, obviously. What were your impressions of Travis having had him the last little while?
I think anybody that spent time around him loved the kid, loved the man. He works so hard. He plays the game the right way. And it's like you said, it's one of those things in baseball or in business, you have to give something away to get something. So it's one of those things that we all wish Travis continued success. It's nice that he's in the other league so we can cheer for him still. But it's one of those things that when you want to build and build a championship team, sometimes you got to give some things up.
I mean, I look at Moises Sierra and the numbers he put up in minor leagues this season. They don't really jump off the page at you, but then he comes up with the major leagues and he has great success right away and still continuing to hit the ball the other way. Can you almost throw the numbers out the window when you're talking about Vegas and PCL numbers when you're trying to project how that player will do in the major leagues?
Well, he's a guy that we made some big adjustments with this year. We opened up his stance. Everybody brings up the name Nelson Cruz for him. So we did some things that to see if they work, and he kind of hit the ground running as soon as we changed him. And I think it's a result of that more than just the numbers throughout the year.
Chad Mottola, before we let you go, I mean, here you are in a major league uniform, and you've been working hard, hitting coach in the minor leagues for a little while. You've developed a good reputation. People know you know what you're doing. There's a guy here whose job you don't want to take as long as he's still here. But what goes on for you as far as taking that next step, moving into a big league situation?
Well, Murph and I actually, he was a coach of mine in the minor leagues, and then we coached together all spring training. So we have a great relationship. By no means do I want to undermine him or take his job. I think it's just a case of different voice at different times. And it's just like anything else, you have three guys working the pitchers, and it helps us to talk and share ideas with each other. So having the relationship in the past really helps.
Well, we wish you the best of luck. We know you're working hard with those guys down there. I want to thank you so much for joining us, and enjoy life in the big leagues here in September.
All right, thank you.
There you go, Chad Mottola. Good dude. Yep. It's funny how guys can be hitting instructors when they weren't really great hitters.
Most of them wind up being like, though, Mottola was a lefty masher, and if they'd ever used him properly in the major leagues, he could have been decent. But yeah, it's those nondescript guys who wind up being the hitting coaches.
So it looks like he's probably going to be a part of the Blue Jays staff next season, is one of those guys that's not in uniform during the game, like Luis Rivera.
Yeah, and you know what? Hitting coaches, are more so than anything else, are there to facilitate work. They do flips, and they throw batting practice, and they watch video with people, and that's what he'll do. And he'll do it behind the scenes, and he has to sit in the stands for the game. It's not so terrible. It gives you another set of eyes, and he can talk to Murphy in between, after games, work with the hitters. St. Louis has got one. I think Mike Aldretti works with Mark McGwire, and they won the World Series last year, so obviously that's what did it.
So a new hitting instructor then in AAA, but it's not going to be in Vegas. It's going to be in Buffalo, and we get to talk about fried bologna sandwiches again. It's going to be awesome. We got to do a road trip next year. Hopefully we're doing the video podcast again next year. Maybe we can do one of these
in
Buffalo.
Coca-Cola Field. How cool would that be?
Yeah.
Take the video podcast on the road, fried bologna sandwiches and onion petals and loganberry, and that would be fantastic. It's great that they're moving the team to Buffalo, and there's a huge news conference on. We're taping this Thursday night. On Friday afternoon, they're going to do something in Buffalo with the Rich family. And it's a gorgeous ballpark. It's 99 miles from Rogers Center. It's nothing to get there. And just to get them out of the Pacific Coast League is so huge. And to be able to get a guy here in an hour and a half, if you need him, is equal. I mean, you could potentially take batting practice in Buffalo and play in the game in Toronto the same night. And it's just, everything is right about this move.
The top pitching prospects are also now going to go back through AAA, which they hadn't been normally coming up from AA in New Hampshire. Tom Cheek, onto the second round. So are you, but don't vote for Mike. You dare vote for Mike. You got to vote for Tom Cheek, though. Mm-hmm. And I alerted you to the fact that we got to use a different hashtag on Twitter as well.
Yeah, because there's some British
Tom
pop
Daly.
Star. I don't know who
he's not a pop star. He's the diver. Didn't you watch the Olympics? Tom Daly, the diver. He got to redo a dive because someone took a picture in the middle of his dive.
Was this golf?
Yeah, I know. It's diving. So anyways, but he's a big celebrity in Great Britain. And they vote
Why
for
are they
Tom.
Why voting for him?
Because
for
he, a teen... Award something, I don't know, some stupid award. But so vote for Tom Cheek is the new, or are you going to stick with
I don't know, because it's too long. We have character limits.
Yeah, I know.
So I might change to vote Tom Cheek or something. But yeah, you got to go vote for Tom Cheek. Every day, the voting goes until 5 o'clock Eastern time, 5 p.m. Eastern time on October 5th. And there are 41 names on the ballot remaining out of the original 222. This 41 is going to get cut down to 3. So it's imperative that you go every day, every 24 hours, which kind of sucks. You got to make sure you vote before 5 o'clock so you can get as many votes in as possible. Facebook.com/baseballhall, and then you like the page, you click on the 13 frick voting, and Tom's right on the first page. No matter how lazy you are, just go down a little bit, boom, Tom Cheek, and vote for Tom. And I know there are a lot of people out there who don't like Facebook, who have some moral opposition to Facebook. I don't care. Get a Facebook account. Don't tell them who you are. Make it up, whatever, just for until October 5th so that you can vote for Tom Cheek. This is, I think, the 7th straight year. I got an email from his wife, Shirley, yesterday thanking us for doing all this and for going out and voting and how much she appreciates it and how humbled she is by it and how wonderful Tom would feel, which is great to hear. So we got to keep doing it. 7 years, we've gotten him on this final ballot every time. They've ignored us so far. But I don't know how much longer they'll be able to ignore us. So please, keep doing it. Vote for Tom Cheek, only Tom Cheek, once a day, every day until October 5th.
Yeah, I certainly want to do that. You also want to follow Mike on Twitter at Wilderness59. You can follow me on Twitter as well, at BennisSNet. Yeah, you do. Also, you can check out our audio podcast on Sportsnet590.ca and iTunes. The Blue Jays this week. We're running out of video podcasts soon. There's a couple more.
It's going to be over soon.
I don't know if we're doing any during the playoffs, but it looks like not. Our producer Eric says he doesn't want to do these. He's lazy, I guess. I don't know. It's whatever. And Jeff
would do it.
Yeah, our cameraman Jeff wants to do it, but we'll figure it out. Whatever. We'll be doing some audio podcasts as well. Blue Jays this week on Sportsnet590.ca. He's Mike Wilner. I'm Ben Ennis. We'll see you next week.